Once again, hello, my friends, and welcome to our worship space. This space that is becoming increasingly familiar, even as perhaps it feels increasingly constricting. I wish so much we could be together in person, but I look forward to that day, whenever it may come. So I invite you to sit back and prepare your hearts for worship. And while you are doing that, you can ponder our question of the day, which is, where did you see abundant life this week?
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon.
Please join me in the call to worship. Awaken from your slumber and bring your fears and anxieties into the presence of the Lord our God. Hear the call of our shepherd and allow his voice to lead from fear of want to the feast of grace. May the light of Christ shine into the hidden darkness of our lives and restore us for the service of the Lord. Come, let us worship God. And now I invite you to rise in body or in spirit to sing our opening hymn, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is, or if you wish, to just sit and listen while Andy sings it for us.
Spirit of God.
you join me now in our confession? Faithful God, in these times of deep uncertainty, it is so easy to lose our way, to fail to hear the sound of your voice calling to us, even in this wilderness. It is so easy to misidentify the one climbing over the wall as the shepherd who will guide our steps. Open our ears that we may hear your words of comfort and guidance, love and encouragement. Sharpen our senses that we may follow you closely as we navigate the unfamiliar paths of our global pandemic. Forgive us when we forget how to listen. Encourage us when we fail to hear. Lead us even when we wander away. Give us sight when we fail to see. And inspire us always to look for you as the gateway to the sheepfold, where we can sink into the comfort of your saving grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. My friends, hear the good news. This Jesus whom we follow, this good shepherd who guides our steps, has already forgiven us our failings and mistakes. This God who loves us beyond our wildest imaginings has already extended grace to cover all our sins. Know that we are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Our reading this morning comes from the Gospel of John in the 10th chapter, verses 1 to 10. Hear the word of God for the people of God. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Most of you have probably noticed that I often end our prayers together by praying in the name of the one who came that we might have life and have it abundantly. Of course, that is the final verse of our reading today. And what a beautiful image it presents us. Jesus, the good shepherd, the gate through which we are invited to pass, offering us abundant life. Abundant life. Take a minute and picture in your mind what abundant life looks like. If you're worshiping with someone else, maybe you want to stop here and imagine that together. When I think of abundant life, I immediately picture myself standing in the midst of a forest with wonderful green growth just dripping from the trees surrounding me, the sound of birdsong filling my ears, the smell of fresh earth wafting up from the forest floor. I feel the sun on my face and hear the wind sighing in the branches high above me. I imagine sinking into a hammock hung between trees to let a nap overtake me as I gently swing. Wouldn't that be wonderful right now? I don't know about you, but this week I hit some kind of internal limit on quarantining, running out of energy for enduring the low-grade anxiety that accompanies my day as I read the latest news or venture out to St. Joe's or hear from congregation members and friends and family who are scared or lonely or impatient or suffering. I've run low on energy to face the constant uncertainty of our future and the distress of those around me. I have run low on spiritual resources as I prepare to sit in my office in the silence of a weird vacuum and try to create worship that will be meaningful for you. Worship that is meant to take place in community, but best protects abundant life by occurring in an isolated silence with each of us in our own particular space. What, I wonder, does abundant life look like in a pandemic? How can we embrace that image when the numbers of our dead have reached into the tens of thousands? when our healthcare workers and first responders have been asked to stretch far beyond their limits, when our hearts are breaking open in grief, when we are crying out to God, "Where are you?" And as I sit here, I hear the answer and the promise echoing back to me. Even now, abundant life still flows towards us in the voice and person of Jesus. "I am here," he says. "I am the good shepherd, the one who knows your name, the one whose voice you recognize, the one who lies down between you and the wolves that hound you, the one who will walk ahead of you to lead the way. And I am the gate through which you pass, the one through whom you come in and go out to find pasture, the one through whom you will find salvation, the one who brings you abundant life." Jesus makes the statement plain in the verse that immediately follows our passage today. "I am the good shepherd." Finally, no more confusing figures of speech, just the simple sentence, "I am the shepherd." In these days, too, when all feels so unsettling, when our relationships are being tested, when we are feeling impatience and grief, when we face the loss of the world as we have always known it, even in these days, too, Jesus remains our shepherd, our gate into the safety of the pen, our guide to the still waters and the green grass, our source of abundant life. The challenge is to embrace this abundant life as it is being offered to us, to discern which ones are the false shepherds who have jumped over the wall into our pen and now offer us not abundant life, but destruction and theft. Which ones offer the fake news of unscientific cures? Which ones suggest aid that helps those who already have abundant material life at the expense of those who have less than nothing? Which ones peddle a false hope that ignores the very real challenges of slow-moving research into viable cures and sustainable life choices? First, we have to recognize who the shepherd is. Fortunately, Jesus describes this shepherd for us, so we will recognize him. The good shepherd enters by the gate. He doesn't sneak over the wall to take us by surprise. He waits for the gatekeeper to open the gate for him, and then we hear his voice, and we recognize it. Jesus tells us in the second part of the passage that he is this gate by which the shepherd enters. And I find myself thinking again about how we, as communities of faith, are also charged to serve as Jesus' body in the world. We, as Jesus, collectively enter into each other's pens, coming in by way of the gate, by way of Jesus himself, who shows us the way. We enter by living out the commandments Jesus has given us, to love God and to love one another. This is how we enter through Jesus, the gate, into the sheepfold. And when Jesus enters our world, when the Good Shepherd comes in through the gate, we recognize him, don't we? Did you notice Jesus entering your place this week? I saw him. I saw him in the generous spirit of my friend Trudy at St. Joe's when she unhesitatingly offered to cook a weekly meal for 50 of our homeless friends who are staying in a nearby hotel. I heard his voice in the kind words of a friend who offered me encouragement and support when I needed it. I felt his warm presence in the arms of my family members. I recognized his voice in the ponderings of our online Bible study and the words of love shared within that community. We recognize the Good Shepherd when he comes in by the gate, living a life that models itself after the teachings of the gatekeeper himself, the teachings of Jesus, our own Good Shepherd. Each of us, I think, is called to be a shepherd for the sheep God places in our care. As our son Dylan so astutely noted to me, we, each of us, are both shepherd and sheep. And we are part of God's plan to care for God's people. We are to shepherd one another by entering into each other's lives through the gate of Jesus' commandments. We recognize the shepherd's voice because it offers love and compassion. It speaks truth and wisdom. It builds up in place of tearing apart. It notices the poor and the marginalized. It lifts up the hurting and the hungry. It offers abundant life. The shepherd calls the sheep by name and leads them out. Our God is a God who knows us intimately, who speaks our names and leads us out to the pastures, the places that will feed and nurture us. Have you heard the shepherd calling your name? What was that like? How did you recognize that voice? What was it like to respond and to follow? Often, I think, when we speak each other's names, when we learn each other's stories and offer compassion and wisdom, love and witness, we do the work of leading each other out into the greener pastures God offers us. The ones that nurture rather than harm, the ones that sustain rather than drain, the ones that offer abundant life, enough for all who wish to come and be fed. Finally, once the shepherd has gathered all his own, he walks before them to lead the way. I love this turn of phrase, all his own, to belong to God, to be God's own. That feels comforting to me. I want to be one of God's own, don't you? To be God's own and to follow God, that sounds like a secure way of proceeding in the world to me. I can handle the world if God leads me and I can rest in the assurance that I am one of God's own. In any case, once the Good Shepherd gathers his own, he goes ahead of them and they follow because they know his voice. He goes ahead of them. The Good Shepherd does not hang back and let someone else take the lead, facing the uncertainties of wolves and ravines, of sudden storms and unexpected injuries. The Good Shepherd leads the way into the unknown, striding ahead of us so that we can follow the sound of his voice and assuming the risks so that we may follow in safety. As we face the consequences of this pandemic, I find this image deeply comforting. The Good Shepherd will lead us out into the uncertainty we face. He will walk first into the storms. He will face the wolves of hunger and homelessness, job loss and grief, suffering and fear. He will walk ahead of us, and he will show us the way. We just have to follow the sound of his voice, the voice that we recognize whenever it speaks words of love and justice for all creation. I wonder whether part of our work as good sheep following our shepherd is to draw attention to his voice and to speak words of truth about those bandits and thieves who have stepped into the pen and tried to lead our community out by another way for another purpose. Where are you called right now to echo the shepherd's voice and call others to return to the flock? This week I had a short text exchange with my friend James, whom I first met when he was living at St. Joe's as a Catholic worker. He lives now in New York City at the Catholic Worker House there, and he was talking to me about what his response should be to the unfolding conflict over the increasing use by the homeless of public transportation vehicles as places to sleep. Governor Cuomo declared this practice disgusting. But James and I just see people with no place to lay their heads and nowhere to shelter in place being called out for attempting to rest in the only places open to them. I found myself asking, where are we called to echo the shepherd's voice and call people back to the loving work of following him instead of being seduced by the thieves and bandits that attempt to secure our loyalty? When sheep encounter a stranger posing as their shepherd, Jesus explains that they will run because they don't know that shepherd's voice. As we wade further into this pandemic, we will be called to listen carefully for the voices of the real shepherd over the sound of thieves and bandits who try to lead us. Again, we will recognize the voices of our authentic shepherd because it will call out words of love and comfort and prophetic truth. We must have the courage to recognize those words and to follow them. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I am the gate by which the shepherd enters. I am the one who comes that you may have life and have it abundantly. This week, let us wonder together, where can we see the shepherd? Where are we being called to play the role of shepherd, entering through the gate that is Jesus' word and teachings? Where are we cautioned to ignore the voices of the bandits and thieves? Where are we called to follow? May we have ears that hear and hearts that answer and hands that are willing to serve. In Jesus' name.
And now in place of our doxology this week, I invite you to just sit back and enjoy this praise song for the pandemic, written and read by Christine Valters-Paintner from Abbey of the Arts with music by Giants and Pilgrims. And it was gifted to us all as just a free piece of music for us to enjoy during this time.
Praise be the nurses and doctors, every medical staff bent over flesh to offer care, for lives saved and lives lost, for showing up either way. Praise for the farmers tilling soil, planting seeds so food can grow, an act of hope if ever there was. Praise be the janitors and garbage collectors, the grocery store clerks and the truck drivers barreling through long, quiet nights. Give thanks for bus drivers, delivery persons, postal workers, and all those keeping an eye on water, gas, and electricity. Blessings on our leaders making hard choices for the common good, offering words of assurance. Celebrate the scientists working a way to understand the thing that plagues us, to find an antidote, and all the medicine makers. Praise be the journalists keeping us informed. Praise be the teachers finding new ways to educate children from afar, and blessings on parents holding it together for them. Blessed are the elderly and those with weakened immune systems, all those who worry for their health. Praise for those who stay at home to protect them. Blessed are the domestic violence victims on lockdown with abusers, the homeless and refugees. Praise for the artists and poets, the singers and storytellers, all those who nourish with words and sound and color. Blessed are the ministers and therapists of every kind, bringing words of comfort. Blessed are the ones whose jobs are lost, who have no savings, who feel fear of the unknown gnawing. Blessed are those in grief, especially who mourn alone. Blessed are those who have passed into the great night. Praise for police and firefighters, paramedics, and all who work to keep us safe. Praise for all the workers and caregivers of every kind. Praise for the sound of notifications, messages from friends reaching across the distance. Give thanks for laughter and kindness. Praise be our four-footed companions with no forethought or anxiety, responding only in love. Praise for the seas and rivers, forests and stones who teach us to endure. Give thanks for your ancestors, for the wars and plagues they endured and survived. Their resilience is in your bones, your blood. Blessed is the water that flows over our hands and the soap that helps keep them clean each time a baptism. Praise every moment of stillness and silence so new voices can be heard. Praise the chance at slowness. Praise be the birds who continue to sing the sky awake each day. Praise for the primrose poking yellow petals from dark earth. Blessed is the air clearing overhead so one day we can breathe deeply again. And when this has passed, may we say that love spread more quickly than any virus ever could. May we say this was not just an ending, but also a place to begin.
My friends, let us now take a moment to offer up all the prayers of our hearts, those spoken and unspoken, remembering that God alone has already heard the voices of our hearts and is preparing an answer for us. Let us pray together. God of abundant life, thank you for the gift of the Good Shepherd. Thank you for teaching us how to hear the Good Shepherd's voice, how to recognize the Good Shepherd's presence among us. Help us to look for that Good Shepherd this week. Give us discerning eyes and ears and hearts so that we may recognize the thieves and bandits when they come, and turn our attention instead to your Good Shepherd, who will lead us out of this chaos, the stress, the fear, the grief, the uncertainty, the restlessness and impatience that we feel. Help us to cling to the knowledge that you will lead us again beside the still waters, into the green pastures. You will restore our souls and you will abide with us, as we certainly abide with you, if only we can open our eyes to notice it. We lift up all those struggling with this pandemic in the many, many ways that they are in pain, whether they are ill with the virus, whether they have lost a loved one, whether they are facing eviction, job loss, hunger, poverty, broken relationships, fear or uncertainty, whether it is the disruption of their lives or the disruption of their relationships. We are thankful that you will be with us always. Lead us now into our communion service, that as we partake of your body and your blood, that we may again abide with you and come closer to you, that we may hear your voice. We pray all these things in the name of the one who came, that we might have life and have it abundantly. In the name of Jesus, amen. It is time now for us to enjoy communion again, virtually together as a community. And if you haven't already got yourself some bread and some grape juice or some wine or whatever you're choosing to use for your feast today, I invite you to pause the video and go and get something. And if you're watching this and you're not in a position to get anything to eat or drink, don't worry, because Jesus offers us the embodiment of his presence, whether we have bread and wine or not. And you can still share with us in this celebration of the Love Feast, whether you have a communion piece in front of you or you don't. So I invite you to join with me in the liturgy now. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. God is with us. We are not alone. Christ is present here. The Spirit moves within us. Let us give thanks to God in memory and in hope. Thanks and praise to you, O God, creator and lover of the universe. You created all that was. You nurture all that is. You imagine all that will be. You are the pattern of community, three in one, God of mercy. From the beginning of time, you have created us for relationship with one another, with the earth, and with you. When we reject your call to community, choosing isolation over partnership and brokenness over healing, you call us back again and again with words of grace and the promise of new life. Remembering that we are not alone at this table, we join our voices with all the saints whom you have called from all times and all places, who forever sing your praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, we praise you for your love, bringing order out of chaos, breathing life into dust, leading captives into freedom, calling wandering children home, giving bread to the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty, raising the dead to life. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son. In his face, we glimpse your glory. In his life, we see your love. In his rising from the grave, we behold the promise of eternal light. We thank you that on the night of his arrest, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and passed it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This bread is the body of life, broken by the world. Eat it in remembrance and in hope." After that, he took the cup, blessed it, and passed it to them, saying, "This cup is the sign of the new covenant. It offers us insight into new ways of being your followers in the world. Whenever you drink it, remember me." Take this bread and cup, O God, a feast of grace. Take our hearts and lives, an offering of praise. We remember how he poured his love out upon all he met, and we look forward to his return, that we will usher in his reign of peace, love, justice, and light. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Spirit, come. Come and live in us, in this bread, in this cup, in your people.
one in the body, one in the blood, one with Christ, one in ministry, in this place, in every place, in this world, in the world to come. Let us pray with one voice as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forget our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Holy Spirit, come into this bread and this cup. Transform these ordinary objects as you change our hearts to shape and form your world with the joy that you promise. Illumine our lives, O God, with the radiance of Christ's love, that we may live for you and love as he loved. Give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Jesus invites those who trust him and those who are trying to trust him to come to this table where all are welcome. Come this day and be fed.
Will you join me in our post-communion prayer? Gracious God, we give you thanks that by the witness of your word and the sharing of this meal, you have opened our hearts and eyes to the presence of Christ among us. Strengthen our faith to follow your voice and attend to your ways, and send us forth from this table by the power of your Spirit to live out this good news for the benefit of your world. Amen. I invite you to stand now in body or in spirit as you are able and so moved to either sing together or to listen to Andy singing for us, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy Faithfulness.
with your trust in the Good Shepherd, and let us love, not just in words, but in truth and action. Believe in the name of Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. And may God be at your side, even in the valleys of death. May Christ Jesus be the cornerstone of your life. And may the Holy Spirit abide in you and tend you with love and mercy all the days of your life. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.